So for our first activity, we're going to pass out some mystery bags. They're not really mysteries. They're strips of paper. And on the strips of paper will be a mathematical practice. And on the left side will be teacher does. So it'll be descriptors of teacher does that fit with that practice. And then on the right side will be descriptors of student does. Just the headings aren't on there because we cut them up. And what we'd like you to do is pull one of the practices and try to think about where you saw that happen in your classroom last year, or where it could happen in your classroom. Any questions? What about four, modeling with mathematics? Does anyone do four, modeling with mathematics? What about practice?
And they're thinking, what's already, you don't know what's already.
Practice seven. Is look for and make use of structure. Did anyone see that in their classroom or could think about what that might look like? Does look for, develop and generalize relationships and patterns, apply conjectures about patterns and properties to new situations. Share out here in some of the discussion I heard at the tables, you can see elements of the different practices, very similar to the discussion we had when we talked about the science practices. There are elements of the different practices that intertwine throughout the other. I mean, I heard looking for patterns in several of these as well.
So today, you are going to be digging a little deeper in one of the math practices. And tomorrow, you'll dig a little deeper in a science practice. But today, you're going to be using, well, you're going to start with a string, and you're going to use this string, this happy little puppy loves to run free and run away, so we have to somehow create a pen that will keep him enclosed. So what we're going to do is we're going to pass out a piece of string, and we just want you to kind of play with it and kind of come up with several ideas of what a pen could look like to keep the little puppy safe and sound so he doesn't, you know, run out to the street or something. Okay, so just a little hands-on time with a piece of string. You guys came up with several different shapes, and I saw that you were working with each other, or at least looking at each other's designs, which was good. That's what that was the next step, to take a look at that, but you guys already did that. So I want to ask you, what makes a good pen for a dog? What are some of the requirements for a good pen? All right, so your next task, using your notebook, is we would like you to come up with an idea. You have to create, these are your constraints, you have to create a dog enclosure that's a rectangular pen, and the area is 12 meters square. All right? So individually, in your notebook, see what are the different types or enclosures that you can come up with so that it meets those constraints. Okay? And you can do it however you would like in your notebook. Go ahead, we're going to give you a few minutes to write or sketch some of those out. So, without giving me any examples, did anybody come up with more than one way to do it? Yeah? Okay, cool. But don't tell me what that is yet, okay? So, what I'd like you to do is turn to somebody at your table that maybe you haven't talked to yet and share what you each came up with, the different ways that you came up with for your enclosure. Do you notice anything, any kind of a relationship just between these two numbers, the two and the one?
Double is a pen.
Go by one?
One's double,
yeah. One.
It's, so one is?
One is
half.
Two.
Half.
Two. Two. Okay.
12.
Six is
half.
Yes.
Half.
12.
Six.
Or
six
the other way around.
Okay. So let's go on the track that where Roseanne was heading. So what would be half of one?
25.
24. Times, I heard.
24.
24. And aren't these also factors of 12?
Mm-hmm.
Couldn't we create a rectangle that looks, okay, that represents that?
Okay.
It has to be rectangular shape, enclosed, in an area of 12 meters square. These all work so far.
Correct.
I'd like you to find out, see if you can find some other ways that still meet these constraints. Go. But could still fall on our chart somewhere.
Four, three.
Okay? Could be anywhere Anywhere. Anywhere.
All right. So go ahead and no, we're going to ask you absolutely no devices at this time. Yes, I know.
Yes, you have no devices right now.
Let's see, I think struggling and working, persevering is part of the math practices, so that's what we're going to ask you to do right now. On an end note, I think it sounds like the consensus is that it meets the constraints, but the measurements or the dimensions do not necessarily have to be whole numbers. Correct? Is that what I'm,
yes.
I mean, that's what I'm kind of getting the gist from you guys, okay? All right, so now we're gonna move on to the next step, okay?
So individually, in your notebooks, I want you to use the same thinking and the same process that we went through to make a pen for the area of 12 meters squared, and record ideas for a pen that's 16 meters squared.
Right.
So take about 2 minutes to list some dimensions that would fit for a pen that's 16 meters
squared.
So
then that would make 2.4.
Our doggy here
times 6.4
doesn't really like to, even though he looks like he likes those long stretches. He doesn't really like the long ones. He likes to kind of run in circles. And we're looking for a pen that will be the optimal dimensions for this doggy. And we also only have so much money to spend on fencing because we're teachers. So we're looking for the dimensions that would require the least amount of cost, least amount of fencing. So think of the dog, have a conversation looking at your list of dimensions and which one would fit the optimal pen. 16 square meters.
It would have to be 4x4 because that is a perimeter of 16, which is the least amount of cost.
16.
Okay.
What was the circle?
So the perimeter being 16, is that the smallest perimeter?
Yes.
Okay. Now I want you to go back to this area. 12 meters squared. And we want to get as close to a square as possible. Can you get closer than 3x4? Our field right now with what our thinking is. So we thought about if you have an area of 16, each side would be 4. And if we have an area of 9, each side would be
3.
And what we're looking for is an area of 12. So one way to think about this is, you know, partway between. And some of you did this. And so you had
3.5 didn't work.
Uh-huh.
It didn't work.
And so a 3.5 by a 3.5 came out to
12.25.
Go. Didn't quite work, but it's closer, right? Okay. So it didn't work because it's over by how much?
0.25.
Okay. Is to find the side length of a square that will have the area of 12. Try to pull yourself away from this problem, finding the exact answer right now. Know where you been. And I'd like you to think about the process that you were going through to come up with these numbers. And I'd like you to write the process down. So step one, you did this. Step two, step three. So work with the people at your table to try to write down some steps
in your notebook
that you could use to get close for any number that's not a perfect square, like 20 or 10 or 14
How would you find?
So what steps could you use? Try out your procedure on a different number. So you guys wrote down a procedure for getting as close to the square dimensions as possible. So now try the procedure that you wrote down for a number like 20 or 10. And see if your procedure works for another number other than 12. The point is that what you've been doing is coming up with an algorithm. So when you push into your calculator square root of 12, which I know many of you were dying to do, the calculator spits out a number. But the calculator has not memorized, for example, the square root of 12. What it has done is gone through a series of steps very, 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 very quickly to spit out a number, to get it closer and closer and closer to the square. Using a mathematical practice.
Persevere.
Well, a calculator doesn't really need to persevere, but it has gone through repeated reasoning to come up with an answer. And that's what you have done very laboriously. And in the real world, would you do that? No. But that is where that kind of thinking, those kinds of numbers come up. So now, go ahead, take out a device, and look at the square root of 12.
Yay! We're going to give you a list of the math practices. And I'd like you to think back to your challenge, which was coming up with the perfect square for 12 meters, what the length of the sides would be. And looking at just the teacher side, what the teacher does, see if you can figure out which ones apply to the challenge part of today's session. All right, as a student, right, as a student going through the process for the 12 square meters, yes, which practice did you take a look at math practice number 8? And as you're looking at it, I want you to think, what does a teacher need to provide in order for students to exhibit mathematical practice number 8? What does the teacher need to do?
Mathematically proficient students notice if calculations are repeated and look both for general methods and for shortcuts. As they work to solve a problem, mathematically proficient students maintain oversight of the process while attending to the details. They continually evaluate the reasonableness of their intermediate results.
Good. So in general, that's the math practice number 8. However, so now we're going to break it down a couple different grade levels. So here's third grade. So, do we have a third grade teacher in here?
Students notice repetitive actions in computations and look for shortcut methods. Students should be encouraged to answer questions such as, what is happening in this situation?
Okay.
Or, what predictions or generalizations can this have?
So, I mean, because it's going to look a little different, obviously, depending on your grade level.
All right. Students use repetitive reasoning to understand algorithms and make generalizations about patterns. Teachers might ask, can you explain how this strategy works in other situations? Is this always true, sometimes true?
There you go.
Use iterative, processes to determine more precise rational approximations for irrational numbers. Students should be encouraged to answer questions such as, how would we prove that?
All right, so remember a while back I said, all right, we'll get to what grade level you think it is at the end. So here we are. So now that you've been through this process, what grade level do you think this lesson or this activity was geared for?
8.
So it is this activity was at 8th grade. And some of the big things that kind of the takeaway is, you know, struggle is good, and that's, you guys all experienced that because we kept reminding you, don't take your calculators out. There was a reason. Struggle is good, you know? But did you persevere? Heck yeah, you guys all did.
And tons of opportunity to make decisions. We did not tell you, go through these steps to find a number that will work. You had that time to make those decisions. So in our classrooms, students learn when they have those opportunities to make decisions.